Dear colleagues and comrades, this is how Stan addresses all of us in the prologue of the book. For him, colleagues, comrades are interchangeable, not comrade linked to some ultra-Maoist groups. I feel so privileged, and the Institute, Indian Social Institute, Bangalore, feels so privileged to bring out this memoir written completely by Stan. My short presentation will have two parts. First part, I just want to say the genesis of this book, how it came, this memoir, and briefly, not every chapter, briefly about the content of the book itself. In the prologue, Stan writes, "Many of my friends," some of you are here, "you have requested me, why don't you put my reflections, experiences in a written form? So it's a labor of love. Take it for what it is worth." And what he's saying is, what I have written, these experiences have really shaped me up to be what I am today. And that is what I'm sharing. I'm not preaching the choir, but I'm sharing my experiences, my journey on different occasions, and this is the product of that. In fact, 2019, as you know, there were some political compulsions. Once in 4 or 5 years, he used to come to South to meet his friends in Karnataka, Kerala, and Tamil Nadu. And that was his due. He already told me, that's a year I took over, because I returned from outside, took over as the director of Indian Social Institute, Bangalore, 2019 July. He was about to come, but at that time there was some, the Patalgadi situation was becoming a little bad. Then I think he consulted some of his friends, including dear friend David Dice. All of your advice, it's better, Stan, you go, you have to meet your friends, also take care of your health. Then he asked me, Father Solomon asked me, Stan has to come, can he come? Of course, most welcome, it is his place. So I'm here, Jesuit community is here. This is where he has worked for about 16 years, 10 years plus he was a director, he's most welcome. Knowing well Stan, because 2001 onwards I had close contacts, he was also so happy, Joe is there, I'm going there. That's how he came up, he came to Bangalore. During that time he said, Joe, people have been asking me to put down my experiences. Just give me some old computer, I will start typing. He had something handwritten, no, all these, some sort of typed out materials, asked me to type it out and give, then he started working. He carried that in a pen drive wherever he went, to Madurai, Dhaka and all that, he gave a shape to the whole writings. He wrote about 11 glimpses, he's not calling chapters, 11 glimpses, glimpses, 11, you know, 11 peak experiences of his moment. Then when he came back, he gave it to PM Tony, who went through sort of an editing, copy editing of that whole thing. Then both of them almost agreed on that. He himself contacted Nandini Sundar, asked for a foreword, and when it came to me with the foreword, his prologue and the 11 glimpses, prologue and epilogue, that's what reached me. Stan, yes. And when he was in Bangalore, he told me, I want you, Indian Social Institute, Bangalore, to publish it. Give me some free copies. I want to give it to my friends freely. I had agreed, yes, then I will do it. The final product was almost ready in the month of June, middle of or first week of July 2020. But within a week, the NIA inquiry started. That's all. So I had to request him, coax him, impress upon him, Stan, let's wait for some time. Let's not bring it out immediately. Why? There was only one reason. When NIA was there for 5-6 days for an inquiry, their only request, command was, please don't share this, that we are coming and inquiring you outside. That was the thing. We said, we'll respect it. Because we have nothing to hide. You have been speaking the truth. Let it subside. Then we will bring out the book. Henry Tiffany is another one. Me, Solomon and Stan used to practically every other day speak about this, what has been happening. One of his concerns was his book. I said, let's delay a bit. Generally, somehow, I don't know, the chemistry between me and Stan worked well. Finally, okay, Joe, since you are saying, we'll wait. Fine. As you know, October, just before the arrest, I came, he called me, what, two, first, second, third of October, I was here. I saw him radiating with a light. He knew what was happening to him. He knew what was going to happen. In a sense, he was prepared. Fine, I will not go into the details of it. Later, when he went to the prison, he reminded me at least a couple of times, Joe, is it the right time to bring out that book? Stan, wait. First, we are working on the bail. Come out on bail, then we will release it. I thought he will leave me with that. He goes to the hospital. From hospital, he reminds me, how about the book? When are you going to bring it out? Stan, I have promised you that I will bring it out. You know that I will bring it out. Yeah, yeah, I know you will bring it out. Okay, you bring it out whenever it's appropriate. Probably today is the appropriate day when he is not with us. And I'm so happy we are releasing it in Ranchi, where he has lived his life fully, and also in Trichy, where he had his own friends in South India because of the ISI Bangalore contact. Now, I move on to the second part of it. Many people, eminent people, have spoken about Stan, his values and all that. Yes, repeatedly when I reflect in hindsight, many things come to my mind. He still, in a way, looks to me a mystery. I'm still trying to understand him. With my own limited experience, particularly the last 2 years and earlier in the founding of Bagaicha, he stood for a particular value system. And he also found the clash of values is a basic issue that we are grappling with. In a secular language, he will put it this way. The clash is between capitalism and the consumerism, the corporatization, and the socialistic values. This is how we will start explaining things. But for me, for him, the socialism is a combination of multiple dimensions. This is what I cherish most. For him, one is of the gospel ethics, where he will not even go to the established institutionalized church, but the historical life of Jesus. That's why even in the prison, he asked me, please get me this book, Jesus and Historical Approximation. They had long discussion in the prison on this book, where Jose Pagola, a Spanish writer, writes how the poor have been kept in the forefront by Jesus. The excluded people were the center of Jesus' life and ministry. That was his thing. And the second dimension was his constitutional principles. Always he will talk about liberty, justice, equality, fraternity. It was so close to him. And the third dimension, much more important, is the Adivasi culture and tradition. He found the combination of these three was the foundation of his value system, which we might call it in terms of, say, like a compassion, truth, justice, freedom, dignity, most importantly, which is emphasized. You will find entirely in his writings, this is what is coming about. Some people talk about conversion. I'm not going to speak on that. But he wanted in a society, the core must be the poor, the marginalized, social justice. That must be the core. All the other organs, including whether the corporate companies, the state, including the church, must be at the service of the poor, maintaining the social justice. This was his call. But this was not often understood. That's why in the funeral I said, Stan was understood and equally misunderstood by many people. I move on to the book as such. Just to give a glimpse of it, you will have the book here. The first chapter itself, he starts with the national emergency. Because it is 1975, he took over as the director of Indian Social Institute, Bangalore. That's the year of emergency. He condemns emergency. And one of the key issues that he dealt with, land to the tiller in Bangalore. Because many of the poor Dalits have been working as tillers, landless people, but working as a tillers. And some of the lands were owned by the prominent Catholic people. Stan went to the poor and worked with them, demanded that is a policy. Today, as Dayamani Barla rightly mentioned, the minerals belong to the people. He started there, the lands belong to the tiller in 1975. And he came in clash with the church authorities. The church authorities did not appreciate him. And he writes, fortunately, the Society of Jesus stood by me and they said, what you are doing is right. He writes it exactly. That's how. So, nobody in the sense, he had no personal vengeance. He was not against anybody, but he want conversion of political parties, conversion of state, conversion of church, conversion of all in authority to be at the service, service in the sense of justice to the poor and the marginalized, whose dignity is violated, regain that. That was his mission and call. And the second chapter immediately jumps from there, out of the 11 glimpses. The second chapter, he talks about, if you can make it a little bigger, he talks about the magnet that attracted him. You know, the first, his foundational experience was among the Hood tribe when he visited in the boarding school where he was a what we call prefect. He goes to a tribal village, Ho village, where the Adivasi boy's father asks his son to pluck the mangoes. And one of the branches, he says, don't touch. When Stan asks him, that's for the birds of the earth. That's what he says is a magnet that attracted me. The environmental care and concern. Today, the society of Jesus is talking about, that's what we are talking about. Walking with the excluded, whose dignity is violated, showing way to God, accompanying the youth, and also caring for the common home. He experienced this. That's why his value system was historical Jesus, constitutional principles, Adivasi's culture and tradition. Of course, he recognized later, this is eroding now. The capitalism, the consumer is taking over. Even it is intruding into Adivasi leadership. He will not even bear them. I mean, he will not leave them. Even when the Adivasi leaders were changing into political parties, leaving the Adivasis, he will challenge them. He wanted them to really look at social justice, justice to the poor through a collective action. This is what it is. Now, because he has given me the full right, I have added chapter 12, 13, 14. I want to emphasize on that. This is not my writing, it is Stan's writing. Chapter 12 contains the NIA inquiry with Stan. Because immediately after all the inquiry, we had requested him to put his writings. That's a writing we sent to some of our close friends. Then later we made it public also. Now it's a public document. Okay. When one of our lawyer friends, Advocate Nithya Ramakrishna from Supreme Court, when she read it, she said, Stan speaks the truth. Only truth will save him. He has written all the inquiry that has happened. It's a long piece. And finally, the NIA inquirer himself says, I have done my job, but I will hand it over to my officials. They will decide. Message is very clearly communicated. And chapter 13, before he went, because he was had a very deep insight about himself, and he knew what was going to happen, he writes, if and when I am arrested. Because as some of you know, that he decided to go for a fast and all that. But at the end of it, he talked to our friends, and in the Adivasi culture, fast is not the right thing. Then he decides to become prisoner of conscience. That's how he moves on. And the 14th glimpse, what the letters he has written to me, he has written over 10 letters and many communications over the phone. I have put them, and the poems you have seen, all of them which reached me, I have tried to put them together to meet his address. This is of the 14 chapters, ending with an epilogue. And as many of you have said, simple, deeply aware of himself, deeply aware of what is happening to him, and man of few words. When he spoke, his words were very, very powerful. On three occasions, I just want to remember three occasions where he had expressed his concern from prison. He asked me once, how is it this superstar issue became so huge? I have learned to live as a poor man, both from the Society of Jesus and Adivasis. How did it become? I said, I myself don't know. Somehow the message went to Susan, the advocate who was coordinating. Susan told our lawyer, that's how I came to know. Fine, he understood it was not an intentional way of that. He says, even without a zipper, I can live. What is the big deal about it? Why that issue has become so big? Then second, in April, as you know, the Jesuits wanted to use his birthday as a solidarity day. We got some prayer services, sent greetings. Then he told me, you must be the culprit to doing all these things, you and Solomon, because this old man doesn't require a celebration, birthday celebration. And the third, from the hospital, tells me, why Society of Jesus money is spent on this old man? Please put me in an ordinary ward. Stan, we are not spending. It's a sister's place, simple hospital. Just go through. We want, we are interested in your help. This is what Stan is. As you know, this is one thing which I want to say on particular way, freedom. This is the last piece that I have received. His own co-prisoners, Arun Ferreira, Vernon, Anand Teltumbe. Middle of May, it's around the 14th, that was a call. He said, I don't know what is happening. Probably COVID was peak at that time. Later he became negative. That's a different issue. At that time, we were all trying to get him out, at least to an hospital. You would have noticed, he, the High Court judge, had an interaction with him from prison through a video conference. Stan's statement was very clear. Either if you are freeing me, allow me to go to Ranchi. That was his statement. Even his co-accused didn't understand. Because we use our practical wisdom and argue, Stan, please accept. But he was very adamant. Reluctantly, he finally agreed for that freedom. Now I understand the meaning of that freedom in a different sense. They also told me, Joe, you have to speak to him so that he accepts that to come to hospital. Otherwise, court is not going to allow him to come to Ranchi. It's a practical way of looking at it. Then on 23rd, we made a call. He called me, Stan, it's a request from me, Jamshedpur Provincial, POSA and all that. Please accept so that you may be treated. We know your health is important. Finally, okay, Joe, I agree. Then the following week, we sent the affidavit. He could not sign. He put his fingerprints. Then it came, you know, 28th, he was taken to hospital. After all that, at the end, after his death, Arun Ferreira, who has been taking care of him as a mother almost for 4 or 5 months, he has written a beautiful letter to us, to his wife and others. I never understood Stan's meaning of freedom, which now I understand in hindsight. For him, freedom is not getting bail. Freedom is not going to hospital. Freedom is to be with his people. If I'm not going to be with my people, I don't need freedom. This is the experience. I'm not saying Arun has written a letter 10th July after his death. Now we understand what Stan means by freedom. Friends, this is the value, this is the person he stood for. The same freedom he wanted for his people. And on this day, we are proud of him as we are committing ourselves to take forward his legacy. Some of you might ask a couple of issues, just brief. Some of you, I think there's a conception of asking me why Stan's body was cremated. Stan is here, Jerry is here. We had limited options because he was still in custody. Either he had to be buried in Mumbai or we cremate and bring the ashes. Right or wrong, history will say the Jesuits decided to cremate and bring the ashes because his desire was to be buried. So otherwise we should bury in Bombay. We could not, court did not allow us to bring the body. Very clear mandate. Okay. Some are asking, what happens to Stan if the cave is no more? As Susan has said very clearly, it will still remain as BK16. The Society of Jesus will continue to take, even at the legal front. We have committed ourselves, the case will go on. Already PIL is filed. Because ultimately, we are with the entire humanity which is fighting for dignity and rights. For the release of BK16, for the political prisoners, under trials, and for the larger cause. We have told our lawyers very clearly, to the extent it helps for the larger cause, we want to take the process forward. And as John said it very clearly, this is an expression of solidarity. This fight, this struggle, this freedom cannot be achieved by any individual or any individual organization. This solidarity is a symbol of collective action if this is our larger dream. And I wish and pray today that till this world become a better place for the poor, the Adivasis, the Dalits and the other marginalized sections, we have a mission to achieve. And that is the mission that he is leaving it for us to really speak truth to the power, to work for social justice, to work with the excluded till the end of our life. Even if we don't see it, as Stan himself has not seen it, our future will see it. That is the faith that we have today. Thank you so much.